strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, the love is greater. Who can stand against us if I got his voice? Sing with joy now, I got his voice. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, the love is greater. Who can stand against us if I got his voice?
All right, well, welcome everybody to Blue Ridge Bible Church's second ever virtual worship service. So we're glad that you all could come and be a part. I was talking with Pastor Tom about this the other day. He said, Jack, I think you're going to be a YouTube sensation. And I looked and saw 24 subscribers and said, I don't think that's going to happen. Well, that's not the goal at all. This morning, what is our goal? Our goal is to come together and to worship. Now, we're going to be doing this virtually, right? I mean, the hearing of the word is going to be done virtually. The time that we have for giving is going to be done virtually. The singing will be done virtually. But here's the catch. We're going to be doing it together. So having said that, let's start by praying together. Would you bow with me? Our Father in heaven, as we start this time together, that's our emphasis, together with you. Your Holy Spirit will oversee us, and he will guide us. He will lead us into truth through his power and through the power of your word. We're asking that through this time that we have of, even though we got to be separated a little bit, we're actually united in one. Lord, that this would be a unique time of blessing for us. And we pray, too, that it would be a unique blessing unto you. And we will pray and ask it together in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, at this time, we wanted to pass along a few announcements from you. So let's hear from Brittany.
Hey, everyone. Well, the announcements might be a little different, but I still have some important things that I want to make sure you know about this morning. So, first announcement. I want to make sure that I have equipped you to make sure that you know how to stay in contact with our church family right now. So, as usual, our main avenue for communicating when we are not physically together is through our online church community, which we call Blue Ridge Connect. So, here's what's going to happen. Each week, we will continue to send out our Ridge Notes weekly email on Thursday afternoons, but we're going to include a weekly video message from Pastor Jack, just kind of a note of encouragement and an update about where we're at. So, watch for that to come. And second, we're going to pull out some of the info from that email every week and put it on our website at a special page called brbible.org/update. And so that is where you can go if you just need a quick look at, you know, what's happening or maybe what's not happening this week. That go-to page again is brbible.org/update. And then third avenue, for those of you who are participating in a life group or if you're in one of Pastor David's youth group small groups, on Blue Ridge Connect, you can actually participate with members of your group, send messages, you can send comments and receive those in real time. It's actually a way to send text messages as well. So if that's something that you're not participating in or not sure how to use, let me know. I definitely want to make sure that you know how to use Blue Ridge Connect so we can stay in touch right now. So if you need to get in touch with me, my email is office@brbible.org. Okay, second announcement this morning. If you are used to giving your offering when we're together on Sunday mornings, did you know you can give online at brbible.org/give? So just wanted to make us aware of that, and those are your announcements for today.
All right, so I'm going to bring to you all a passage from 1 Peter. We're going to look at chapter 5, verses 6 through 9, and it's really an exhortation from Peter here. Let's listen. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. But resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world.
Let's begin our time with a word of prayer. Would you bow with me? Our Father and our God, right now as we spend this time in your word, as always, we are asking that you would take your word to transform us. This has to be coupled with your Holy Spirit, because left to ourselves, we'll manipulate this or we'll ignore this. We need you to speak. So we're asking that you would do that at this time. But Lord, we're also lifting up our request before you. And just as this thing that's working through our nation right now, everything revolving around this coronavirus, God, our prayer is that you would care for your own and help us to care for your people, but to care for our neighbor. And we're going to need your help, and we're going to need your guidance in that. So would you grant that to us? And we'll pray and ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let me start you out this way. There was a fellow named George, and George was born into slavery. Interesting fact about him, when he was only a week old, both he and his mother were kidnapped from where they were, and the thieves that stole them went and sold them off to somebody else in another state. And his first master was a guy named Moses, and Moses wanted those people back. He wanted his slaves, so he paid a pretty handsome price to get them back, and he found someone that would go to do that. Well, they couldn't find the mother, but they did find George, and they brought George back. And it was Moses' wife, Sally. When they got George back, there was something that was just in her heart that she treated him like a son from that point on. And she purposed that she was going to give him an education. She saw this particular kind of a genius in him. She wanted to provide him opportunities that very few African Americans had at that time. In fact, she and her husband saved up enough, they sent him to college. And then they sent him off to an agricultural department at the Tuskegee Institute, where he became one of the most esteemed botanists in the world. And he even became the agricultural, advisor to the United States president. His name, George Washington Carver. This was a guy that had very humble beginnings, an incredible destiny. In fact, his tombstone reads this: he could have added fortune to fame, but caring for neither, he found happiness and honor in being helpful to the world. Now, I highlight that story to mention another person that God had established a destiny for, who also had some pretty humble beginnings, who could have sought personal fortune and fame, but instead, this individual found delight in being helpful to the world as he submitted to the Father's will and the Father's desires. Today, you and I are looking at a text that speaks about this humble servant that God had very big plans for. And with Easter just around the corner for us, it's a passage that's going to prepare our hearts and lives for what this season will proclaim and shine forth. If you got a Bible, let's turn together once again to the book of Isaiah. We're going to Isaiah, and we're going to go into chapter 49. While you're turning there, let me just tell you a little bit about it. This Isaiah has already given a particular song for a servant, about God's key servant. This is the second time Isaiah is going to do this. And God is beginning to shift away from the problem of a sinful people who are going to go into exile. That's what we've seen in the last 8 chapters. To now dealing with the much larger problem of the sins of all mankind. And the person he's going to use is his servant, the Messiah. So let's begin by looking at his calling by God in Isaiah 49. And here we're going to hear from the servant himself. Follow along with me. Verse 1. Listen to me, O islands, and pay attention, you peoples from afar. The Lord called me from the womb. From the body of my mother, he named me. And he has made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he has concealed me. And he's also made me a select arrow. He has hidden me in his quiver. And he said to me, you are my servant Israel, in whom I will show my glory. But I said, I've toiled in vain. I've spent my strength for nothing and vanity. And yet surely the justice due to me is with the Lord, and my reward with my God. So verse 1, this servant is letting us know that he's been commissioned from before even he was born. By the way, let me just take that and highlight a short note. Because again, he is called before he has come out of his mother's womb. And that reveals something to us, that God has a plan for life. But that value, it is not established only after an individual passes from the womb. The value is there while that child is still in the womb of his or her mother. In fact, this point gets reiterated again later in verse 5. And you and I, we're living at a time when the world argues about when does life begin. The Bible doesn't argue that. That value is established on every single human being at conception. It doesn't happen when you hit the 3-month mark or the 6-month mark, even just when the child is born. Well, this servant was given that commission while he's still in his mother's womb. He's got this God-established destiny about him. And in verse 2, we've seen his purpose is to come and to announce God's words. He's described in this passage as an arrow. Now, we all know what that's like. You know, this is a weapon, but it's a weapon of God. And it's come to conduct an assault. And we're going to see later, it's against an enemy to all of us. This enemy isn't some country. It is sin itself. And verse 3 is where things get a little confusing for us because it says his name is Israel. And the reason this gets confusing is because we've seen sometimes the servant is called Israel, sometimes it's called Cyrus, and sometimes it's called my servant, or meaning the Messiah. Well, who is this guy in this passage? Is he a man? Is he a nation? Well, we need to understand this isn't the nation of Israel. This is someone who's going to be the representative of Israel. This is a Jew who's going to be God's servant. And he is the very embodiment of Israel. And everything that Israel was meant to be, but they hadn't been so far, he's going to be doing and he's going to be accomplishing what Israel couldn't. And yet, in verse 4, he expresses how he feels about his ministry. And this is the part that actually, if I'm going to be very upfront, it makes me a little uncomfortable because it's expressed almost as if he's failed. Again, these are telling us about the coming Messiah, Jesus Christ, and the things that we read at the beginning of verse 4, they kind of make us go, wait, what? What? This is how he feels about his ministry? You know, I remember reading a book, it's been several years now, and it was entitled The 100 Most Influential People in History. And so I opened it, and I'm expecting that I'm going to find Jesus either number 1 or number 2. He was neither. He was listed as number 3. You know, the authors felt like they had to give a reason, figuring people like me are going to go, what are you thinking? What are you talking about? Well, the reason, what they explained, was that they felt that Jesus' ministry was just too small at his death, and that it took the Apostle Paul, whom they also credited as helping to launch the Christian faith, for it to have the impact that it had. So as a result, Jesus got number 3 of the 100 most influential people, and the Apostle Paul fell down to number 6 because they shared in the Christianity effort. Well, I don't necessarily agree with that, but that's not my point. My point is this. When Jesus departed this earth, there weren't a lot of followers. His disciples numbered only about 120. I mean, we start church plants in America with more people than that. And when he came to speak to the Jew first, and the vast majority of the Jews actually rejected him. They rejected his love. They rejected his sacrifice. I got to admit, if this was my ministry, that might get me down a little bit. But as is so often the case when God's at work, the fruit isn't always immediate. Many times it comes later. And Jesus' ministry was going to take time to be revealed. Now, this has very big implications for you and I, because here's the point. A lot of times when it comes to our feelings and our experiences, we're looking for things that are quantifiable to us to validate our ministry towards God. And yet, that's not necessarily what God uses as a measure. I'll give you a great example. There's a guy named Jeremiah who's a prophet in the Old Testament. And God actually told him this about his ministry in, I think it's chapter 7, verse 27, where he said, you're going to speak all these words to them. They're not going to listen to you. And you're going to call to them, but they're not going to answer you. In other words, from a human perspective, your ministry is going to be, it's going to bomb out. It's going to be one of mainly just condemnation of the people. You're not even going to provide hope. And if that's my ministry, I don't like that. And he didn't either. In fact, later on in chapter 20, Jeremiah said this. He says, Lord, you have deceived me, and I was deceived. I've become a laughingstock all day long, and everybody mocks me. Why would he say that? It's because his ministry wasn't measurable in a good sense. That's the same thing that's going on with the servant here. So we look again at verse 4. We can kind of say, look, this is a prophecy of Jesus' feelings, and I've never considered that before personally. Now, we know that Jesus didn't despair. Instead, the verse goes on to say that he looked and said that his reward was with God. So even though there's a little bit of discouragement that comes, he had faith that God could take that which seemed just so small at the time, and he was going to be able to produce a harvest that was greater than anything that you can imagine. That is a message for you and I today. Because we live in a day where we're always looking for these measurable means of what we're doing for God to validate the impact, right? So that when I die, I can die knowing, well, my life wasn't a waste. That's not how we should see things. I offer up Jesus as exhibit A. Often, we're the ones who want to be successful. We want to be the dynamic speakers. We want to have the highest numbers, the most exuberant. Instead, what is God saying? That's not what I've called you to be. I've called you to be faithful. And as a result, we're to let God be the one to make the impact. And it might not result in a type of a seen ministry that you can measure and you would like. And this is especially important right now while we're all locked up in this coronavirus. We're all asking, what is it that you want us to do, Lord? How will we help? And those are good questions. We should be asking that. You know, we're not supposed to be around people to help them. So how are we going to make a difference? Again, good questions. Until our question actually morphs into us really asking, how can I do something, God, that gets me noticed? And that's the wrong question. We need to be like the servant here, like Jesus. The call, you just be faithful. You step forward in humility, and you let God establish your destiny, just like he did with Jesus in his ministry. Let's go back to the servant, verse 5. And now, says the Lord, who formed me from the womb to be his servant, and to bring Jacob back to him so that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God is my strength. And he says, is it too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel? I will also make you a light to the nations so that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. I love this passage, folks. This is the gospel according to Isaiah. And he is describing Jesus to us, explaining why Jesus isn't just some other prophet. He is so much more. And this should bring to mind something. You know, when we go to our New Testament, in the book of John, Jesus said of himself in chapter 8, verse 12, I am the light of the world. It's what we're reading right here. God's destiny for him was to be a light to those who were in darkness. And he was going to start with the Jew. And then that message was going to move out in just like concentric circles in a pond when a rock hits it. It was going to go out to the Gentiles. And we see this in the book of Romans. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's the power of God to salvation, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Israel was to be the very first recipient of the gospel. And the book of Acts shows us this as we see the gospel begins where? Jerusalem, where the Jews were, and then it just goes out from there. Verse 7, thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and its Holy One, to the despised one, to the one abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers, kings will see and arise, princes will bow down, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. And just as George Washington Carver would go from being a slave in that lowly position to being a consultant to the President of the United States, Jesus was going to go from being this despised one to eventually being the one that the world will one day look unto and every knee will bow before him. And I see that and I just think, how backwards of God. He takes the lowly, he takes the despised to make them the one that the highest king is actually going to bow to. Because God works with humility, and then he moves his people towards vindication. And that's what he's doing with Jesus. Now, from this point, Isaiah, he's going to start talking about a vision that he has. And I like this. It's sort of like he's this prophet, and he's looking at this mountain, right? And he can see everything about this mountain. But behind that mountain is another one that just mirrors it almost exactly. And as he's describing this first one and a historical event and the things that are going to happen at that time, it's as if he's describing the same thing for the other mountain peak behind it. So when you read about one, you can see how it just translates over to the other. And here's what I mean. Because in the next few verses, he's going to talk about the liberation of the Jews from exile. But that other mountain peak, that other point in history, is how Jesus is also going to liberate every person from sin's dominion. Verse 8, he says this, "Thus says the Lord, in a favorable time I've answered you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you, and I will keep you and give you for a covenant of the people to restore the land, to make them inherit the desolate heritages." Now, the point made here is huge. You see what it's saying? Jesus will be the covenant of the new people. Now, when we're going through our Bibles, we see numerous times where God makes covenants with his people. Some of them are conditional, where he says, if you do this, then I'm going to do that. But then there's other ones where he says, I'm going to do this, period. No conditions. Give you a great example of this. When you go out after a big rainstorm, you look at that thing in the sky, what's it called? The rainbow, which I'm always trying to reclaim. Because that is a reminder that God made an unconditional covenant with man through Noah. He said, never again am I going to destroy the whole earth by a flood. Man doesn't have to panic every time he sees a thunderstorm and rain starting to fall. God says, I got you covered. Here, we've got a new covenant, and Jesus is that covenant. And the call is to say, look to him, to see God's new covenant, to say, where God is saying, I'm going to deal with your sin. I'm going to take care of it. And the New Testament brings us back to this. It lets us know that we're to come to the cross to see our sin crucified upon him and taken away. And then we walk a little bit further down the road to come to the empty tomb where we see new life given to us. Once a month, and it might be a little longer right now, but once a month we gather together to come to the table. We celebrate what's called communion. And it's here where we are experiencing the reminder that Jesus is the covenant of God. And we're remembering his death in his body. We're remembering the new covenant that we have in his blood. That is so important. And Isaiah is the first one to introduce that to us. And then, using some traveling imagery, he goes on to say, and listen, because of that, because I have this new covenant, it's in my servant, you don't have to be afraid. My own, who are in him, are under my care, and I'm going to provide deliverance from sin. Look at verse 9. He says to those who are bound, go forth. To those who are in darkness, show yourselves. Along the roads they will feed, and their pasture will be on all bare heights. They will not hunger or thirst, nor will the scorching heat or sun strike them down. For he who has compassion on them will lead them and will guide them to springs of water. Now, that's some pretty vivid imagery to a people who would be in exile. Once they were in prison, now they can be free to travel, to go home. And in traveling, they can go without fear of an enemy attacking them. But if you're like me, the next question is, okay, but now where's the food going to come from? Where's the water going to come from? And in that day, it's not like today. You know, I go driving down the road, I can just stop by old Chick-fil-A over here, and I'll get myself a meal, a little chicken sandwich and a Powerade. Well, you couldn't do that in that day. But God is saying to them, look, you don't need to be afraid. I'm going to feed you. I'm going to cover you from the heat. And most important, I'm not only going to give you that life-giving water, I'm going to give it to you in an abundance. And this is speaking a whole lot more than just physical bondage and deliverance from Babylon. This is about the release of the spiritual bondage of sin to a return unto God himself. Now, when you read that, that is meant to move you to realize, to see the burden that is taken off of you and how God has done everything to reach us and to pull us to himself and to keep us to himself. And so what's the result? It's going to be verse 13. It's called a cosmic celebration. Look at what it says. It says, shout for joy, O heavens, and rejoice, O earth. Break forth into joyful shouting, O mountains, for the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted. Now, as I'm reading this, and I say it, you know, it's one thing to just read it. If I had a really awesome tune that I could put this thing to music with. Now you're taking the truth and you're going to put something that's going to bring the emotion behind it. And I was talking with Pastor Tom before this, and I said, Tom, we got to do that. We got to interrupt the service right now to sing about that. So let's do that right now. Let's sing about how God gives us mercy and compassion.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new evermore. Since they are many, His mercy is more.
Don't you love that? I mean, think about, this is what you were just saying. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment. His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. And everybody said, amen. We hear that. We sing that. And right now, we can kind of have our emotions come like the caboose along, and we can feel that too. But we don't always feel it, do we? We don't. And that's the point of the next part of this chapter. It's going to give us a reminder that God remembers his people even when his people don't feel like he does remember them. And that can happen to us when we're in difficulties. When we're on the journey and the sun is hot and bearing down on us, and when bad things are happening, we tend towards feeling like, I don't know that God really is for me. In fact, verse 14 expresses how we sometimes feel, because Israel felt this way. Verse 14 says, but Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me, and the Lord has forgotten me. Again, this mimics the feelings that we saw earlier. It's almost like what we saw in Jesus. What good has all my work actually done? Israel's asking, where is God? Why has it got to be so hard for me right now when I'm his? And I'm confident some of you are going through this right now too. I mean, if your job was lost, if it's being threatened in the future, if some things you were counting on don't seem to be playing out like you had planned, and you can ask the question, I know I have, God, I'm your servant, and I know I'm not entitled to an easy life, but why has it got to be so hard right now? To you in particular, God has a response for that, and it's in verse 15. Can a woman forget her nursing child and have no compassion on the son of her womb? Now, we read that and we say, yeah, a young mother, she's not going to forget her child. And yet, having said that, we can have somebody stand up in the audience and go, no, time out, Jack. I was just reading in the news the other day, and I heard about this time where this mother, she did do this with her children. It's the extreme exception, but sometimes it happens. Well, God knows that sometimes in our despair, we start to look at the exceptions. And to that, he adds to his statement, because he says, even these may forget, but I will not forget you. Behold, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. You ever seen those trees where someone has kind of etched something in them, you know, like Jack plus Karen equals love forever with a heart that goes around it, right? Well, God takes that kind of imagery that we might see in a tree, that carving, something inscribed. He takes it one step further, and he says, I've done that with your name, and I did it in my hand. You know, when I was in college, there was a guy in the room next to me who joined a fraternity. And when he was finally accepted into the fraternity, they had this big celebration to acknowledge everyone who was in. And so he goes out, and they had this big campfire that night, and they had this branding iron that had the logo of their fraternity on it. And they put that branding iron in the fire and got it hot. And every one of these new guys came around, they rolled their shirt up, and they took that brand and they burned it right there on their arms. I don't recommend that. Not a good thing. But he did it. And, you know, when it comes to a tattoo, you can get that removed. Or at least, you know, for the most part. Usually, well, anyway, it can be a mess if you try to get it removed. But when it comes to a brand, I got news for you. You're not removing that. It's in there. And God says, you're inscribed as permanent as a brand mark on me. It's a way that he would tell us, I will always remember you. I will take care of your sins, and I will never let you go. That's how God feels about you. And continuing on with this theme of God's love, even when we have those times where we don't feel it, we can skip down to verse 24 where he asks a question. He says, can the prey be taken from the mighty man? Or the captives of a tyrant be rescued? Surely, thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty man will be taken away, and the prey of the tyrant will be rescued. For I will contend with the one who contends with you, and I will save your sons. I will feed your oppressors with their own flesh, and they will become drunk with their own blood, as with sweet wine. And all flesh will know that I, the Lord, am your Savior and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. You know, that's a pretty rough imagery right there. But there's something we can kind of relate to in it, right? Because you've all probably thought about, or maybe you were one of those little kids where someone else came along and was uttering a threat to you. And, you know, the response, hey, my brother, I'm going to call him over here and he's going to beat you up. You know, because you've got someone who's going to defend you. God is saying, I'm that big brother. And I can care for you, and I will care for you, and I will deliver you to the degree that no one can take you out of his hands. Folks, that which God delivers, he saves, he rescues, and he keeps. And to add to that, he tells us about his desire to deliver his people. Look at chapter 50, verse 1. Thus says the Lord, where's the certificate of divorce by which I have sent your mother away? Or to whom of my creditors did I sell you? Behold, you were sold for your iniquities, and for your transgressions, your mother was sent away. Now, the point of what he's highlighting here is he's saying, look, your sins, they did create a separation between us. But it didn't have to be an eternal separation. God says, because I can take care of them. My servant is going to be the one to do that. Verse 2, why was there no man when I came? And why when I called was there none to answer? Is my hand so short that it cannot ransom? Or have I no power to deliver? Behold, I dry up the sea with my rebuke. I make the rivers a wilderness, and the fish stink for lack of water and die of thirst. God's challenge is, he's saying this, I can deliver. He's God. And sin is not outside of his ability to conquer and overcome. And he can take you and I, the lowly, the one that no one regarded. And he desires to bring his compassion on us by defeating sin through his sacrificial death. What a passage. Isaiah, he gives us more about Jesus Christ than I feel like almost any place else that's at least overtly like this to prepare us for the heart of God and his plan. So what do we do with this? You know, I think there's an application that we take from it. And this is one of those where maybe the biggest application is just that we're going to daily choose to believe this. Because see, if God loves us like he says, and if God has all power like he says, and if God has a destiny for you and I like he says, but we're not abiding in that, we're not exercising that power, we're not walking in that, then we need to realize something. It's not because God's reluctant. It's happening because we're the ones choosing to hang back, to not go where God would have us to go, choosing to not see ourselves as God sees us. And God specializes in taking the humble and bringing them to this incredible destiny. He did it with Jesus Christ, his son, and he's going to do it to you through him as well. You know, today we're dealing with a virus. I want to use that to kind of give you a sort of a memory jog about this text and help you remember this truth. Because if you're like me, for the most part, you ignored this virus. I mean, when 2020 started, I never even heard of a coronavirus. No one paid any attention until its impact started to be felt. And then people understood, you know, this thing may have a power. And now the entire world is responding to it. When you think of that virus in the negative light, I want you to think about Jesus in the positive light, because Jesus also was unnoticed by many. He was born into a relative obscurity. And as he started his first ministry, his first advent, he was unnoticed by most, born into that obscurity, being shunned and ignored. And yet, God had a destiny for him to impact those who would, if I can use the term, who would catch him, to be changed forever. But he is the infection that you never want to lose. So while you and I are trying not to spread the coronavirus, you do spread the message of this Savior, because you know this is something I want within me. This is God's mercy and compassion. And through him, our God is going to continue to impact the entire world. Let's pray together. Our Father and our God, We do want to give you thanks for the great love and the compassion that we did not deserve, but you have granted unto us. And Lord, just as we think about what kind of difference that makes in our life, and yet how often I don't walk in it because I place my eyes and my focus on my sin, not on the fact that you have a destiny for each one of us, and it's through Jesus. Help us to be a church that walks in that. For the people that we will encounter, the communications that we will have, let us be one who encourage one another with this, to call one another to walk in this kind of a faith, knowing that you really do love us. And we know it because all we need to do is look at Jesus, where the new covenant that you wanted with us abides, and we're covered. Help us, Lord, to infect other people with this message. Now, we can't have this take root. Only you can do that in their hearts, but we want to be faithful. We pray and ask that you would do that in and through us. And we'll ask it all in the great and the powerful and the loving name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, where our new covenant resides. Amen. And while this concludes the service, nobody's dismissed. All of you are sent.